Good morning, everybody. How you doing? Could we say hello to the Avenue venue right next door? Hey, Avenue. Good to have you. Welcome, everybody. We've been talking about the love series and love to third power, I guess is what that means up there. And it's about loving God, loving the church, and loving people. And so today we're going to be talking about loving people, that God has a heart for people out there in our community. Let's pray. Father, we love you and honor you. And Lord, we do know you have a heart for people so much. You love people so much that you sent your son. And God, so often in my life and as we go through a busy times and we forget about people around us. We forget about what's going on in other people's lives. We forget about the needs and the hurts and the pains. And God, we're just asking, I'm asking, help us to have a heart for those who are lost, for those who are outside the family of God, who are outside of the community of faith, that don't have a relationship with you yet. God, put in our hearts to look for them. Put in our hearts to understand a little bit more about what life is like without you, and help us to have a heart for, to look for, to seek, and to love those people that are outside of the four walls of the church house, and that we would reach out to them and love them. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, years ago, I had a friend ask me if I would take her dad fishing. This has been probably 20 years ago. And I said, sure. He vacationed here. He was a New York State judge. He's a very, very smart guy, intellectual guy. He had been a New York State judge for a number of years. He was getting close to the end of his career, getting ready to retire in Florida. And so he was wintering here. And so for two winters, I took him fishing with me. And his name is Victor Manz, M-A-N-Z. And his middle initial is E. So on his, you know, judge's campaign. And so his campaign posters would say Victory Manz. Victory Manz, get it? Anyway, it was kind of fun. He's a great guy. And we became good friends. And it was a lot of fun fishing with him and getting to know him and to understand a little bit more about what it's like being a judge. And he was a family judge, so he was always dealing with family issues and kids and in really crisis and what to do with them and how to help those kids. And I just got to really love the guy, and we got to spend time together. And man, it was just good getting to know him. I'll give you a little bit more on him in just a little bit. But what we're called to do is we're called to love God, love the church, love people. And one of the ways that we're trying to do that through East Coast here is we're actually having campuses other places. Having a campus in Cocoa now, a campus in Vieira. We have the Avenue next door. They were the trailblazers. They're the ones who did it first when they were willing to watch it on a screen so that there was more room in here at 10 o'clock, the number one time when maybe a new person might want to come to church. They were willing to make room so that people would be able to come. Trailblazers. But in Vieira, why would we do that? Why would we do one in Cocoa? Because we found that if someone's going to visit a church, if one of the people who go to a church say, would you come with me to church, it works best if it's local. In other words, if you've got to get in the car and drive from Melbourne to Merritt Island to go to church, and then you say, okay, I enjoyed that, that was good, and then you think, I go to church this Sunday, but it's a 40-minute drive. Many people in just getting started would choose not to do that, and they'd say, oh, I don't think so. But if it's closer, the chances are better that, number one, people would say, yes, I'll come to church with you. And number two, they would make the trip because it's not so far. New people don't understand why you drive by 150 churches to get to one down the street. Now, we understand why and all that stuff. Somebody say amen. Amen. But it's important to do that. And so God loves people outside the church. A couple of verses on that. Romans 5. 6-9 says, for when we were still without strength, and in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man, someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love towards us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. See, Christ cares about those outside of his family. Well, the most famous verse of all, of course, is John 3:16. And John 3:16 is, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And again, a great sign that God cares about people outside of his family. What's interesting is somebody told me that verse is exactly 140 characters. If you go to the King James Bible and pull out, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son," if you pull that out, it's 140 characters. Well, what's that mean? Well, if who's a Twitter fan? Anybody tweet in here? Three of us. Okay, that's good. Man, you guys are Twitter. Come on, any young people do Twitter, tweet, anything. Okay, I feel better. A few hands are going up. Somebody said that's what you do when on Twitter is you tweet, and a tweet is 140 characters. In fact, somebody came up with the idea that we communicate through this. Many people thought, oh, that's silly, nobody will ever use it. And then now it's huge, made millions of dollars and gone all over the world. And here's what God did. God, over 2,000 years ago, says, "I'm going to put together the best tweet that could possibly be put together. And I'm just going to sit it right there in the Bible. And when these people figure out how to tweet, I'm already going to have the best tweet ever." Come on. And so, isn't that cool? I thought that was so cool. So I tweeted it. I got a Twitter account and I tweeted. Now, I may never tweet again, but I have tweeted the best tweet that's ever been tweeted, because it came straight from the heart of God. He loves the world so much that he was willing to give it all out there. Here, we're called to reach out. We're called to have open hands. That's what we talked about last year. We had a great Christmas season. I'm so proud of you guys. All the things that happened. I mean, I heard of another testimony where a lady, one of the officers that goes to the mezzanine. We have a sheriff's deputy that goes to the mezzanine, and somebody, a single mom, got her car stolen with all their Christmas stuff in it. And so the deputies were pulling together, and the mezzanine found out about it. They said, "The deputies aren't doing that. We're doing that." And the mezzanine all threw together and raised enough money for the deputies to go down there and take care of that lady and her family's Christmas. You know what? Stuff like that happened. Literally dozens of students, dozens of single Christian moms. We brought 500 shoes to Guatemala. There was a playground built. There were playgrounds built last year. There were a lot of really cool. I mean, I found out about a family. Brian Moore did, and I did, found out about two families Christmas Eve. Now, we were doing services all day, and it's about 8 o'clock, and we got word of another two families. I said, "Brian," I said, "you take one, I'll take the other." We got some of those $10 gift cards. We took the last of the ones that you guys had given. And I stopped by a house on Merritt Island. There were five adults living there and five children. And they had nothing for Christmas, and they had sticks for furniture. And I walked up there and I said, "Here's $200. Target's open till 10. See what you can do with these." And I want to tell you what, there wasn't a dry eye in the house. And you know why? Because you guys are generous. And you're thinking outside the lines of the four walls of the church house, even the missionary Christmas, taking care of the missionaries out there. All this stuff is very, very powerful. I mean, the food ministry, I've never seen it as busy as it was leading up to Christmas time, Thanksgiving. I mean, an incredible amount of people were getting food. And it's just so awesome to see that people are willing to go to the adult entertainment industry. Give out gifts to all the girls that are participating in that. And then seeing lives changed and hearts being touched. It's just so powerful, so grateful for that. The Bible says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations." In other words, one of the main things that was said was, head out, go to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the uttermost parts of the world. Get the gospel out. Now, that to me would be a winning season. What would make 2015... an incredible year? I believe that if we would begin to reach out this year, if we would begin to build relationships with people outside of the church, that we begin to build trust with them, that we would begin to build friendships with them, relationships with them, that if we would begin to reach out and get to know some people around us, maybe on our street, maybe in our community, maybe in our city, maybe somewhere in the county, I don't know where, but if we would begin to do that, and then at some point we would make the decision that we're going to bring them to church, would that be a good thing for East Coast Christian Center? Would that be a good thing for people? Would it be a good thing for our community? I think it would be a win if we would begin to take the relationships that we might have at school or work or wherever we were at and begin to build friendships with them so that they trusted us enough so that when the moment came, we could share the truth with them and that they responded. You know what? I believe it would change our lives. It would change our church. And it will change our community. I want to show you a video. This is a video of someone who has had that very thing happen. They were brought to church and their lives were changed.
I found East Coast through my daughter. She was pulling away from the Catholic Church and was looking for something more where she felt the Holy Spirit. She kept trying to lean me to coming towards East Coast. I came with her a couple times, had a step back, wasn't ready yet. My boys, my younger boys, loved it, wanted to come here. When it was time to go to church, they would ask, which one are we going to? If I said East Coast, they beat me to the car. If I said we're going to the other church, we barely made it on time. I was going through a divorce, really rough time in my life. I was alone, just me and four kids. I really had nobody. And the Hope series last year at Christmas really jumped out at me. And it was like it was written just for me. My kids connected really with Pastor David. You know, anytime they had a problem, they felt very open to go talk to him. And they all had somebody here, and they all, like, you know, they all meshed well, but I felt like I was just going through the motions. And my daughter's like, you have to get plugged in. I'm like, oh, I don't know. I don't want to step outside of my box. My middle son loves the fifth and sixth grade leaders, and they show up at his football games and his cross games. Like, they're really there for the kids. And there was a need for somebody to do the fifth and sixth grade 11:30 service. And I was like, well, maybe that's for me. And that's how I, you know, dove in and got connected. I started teaching Sunday school, and there is hope, and God does love me. There is a family here at East Coast, and my kids have dived in 100%. They want to be here. We would come every night if we could. This is our family. It's our home.
Wow. That's awesome, isn't it? Woo! You know, it's great to bring somebody to church, but what about leading them to church or leading them to Christ yourself? In other words, sitting down with somebody and saying, you know, that Jesus died for you. The reason he died for you is everybody's sinned. Everybody falls short of the glory of God. And that the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. That if you'll confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. What's it like sitting down with somebody and telling them about Jesus? Now, you might think, I don't know, my palms get a little sweaty when I think about doing that. What about this? What if what we're going to do actually is Monday night, tomorrow night, at 6 o'clock, we're going to invite you all back, and we're going to go door to door, and we're going to knock on doors and tell people about Jesus. Just cold turkey. Hi, my name's Dan. Jesus loves you. Can I tell you about the Lord? You know, there's three people that just went like this, and the rest of you went, oh my God. I am thinking of an excuse right now. Why we can't go at 6 o'clock on Monday nights ever, 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 ever. You go, Pastor Dan. That's a great idea. I hope you do well. And here's the truth is, you know, we all know somebody that's an evangelist. Everybody they talk to, they just talk about Jesus. It's easy for them. Hi, how you doing? My name's Bill. I love Jesus. How about you? You know, I love Jesus, me, you too, or something. I don't know, I'm not a cheerleader. But anyway, you know, they get on an airplane, they fly somewhere, they sit in the middle seat, both people get saved on each side. The stewardess gets saved. By the time they land, everybody in economy class is singing Kumbaya. It's like, dude, how do you do that? Like, lady, how do you do that? You know, I've known a few people like that in my life. Like, everybody, they talk to her, you know. Look, we used to have a friend, Mary, what was Mary's last name? Hinterberger, Mary Hinterberger. She won Miss New York, so let's just say she was kind of cute. And so she was actually owned a business, a geological survey business. So she had a lot of money, and she was a real cute girl. But she loved Jesus with all her heart. And all these guys would chase after her, and she'd say, sure, you want to go on a date? They'd ask her, and she'd say, sure, let's go to church. And I literally, every Sunday, she'd come walking in the back. There'd be some lamb headed to the slaughter, following Marianne, going... And I preach the gospel to them, and then Mary go, nice knowing you, and then the next one would come next week, be fresh meat. But she was just like, that's all she, and she was just like, yeah, sure, I'd go out with you, let's go to church. And it was pretty cool and that, but it was, you know, it was just so easy for her. But here's the truth, if you study the church, only about 2 or 3% of the church are actually evangelists. See, the Bible says that God gave gifts. When he ascended on high, he gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. It's a gift. And God only gave that gift to a few people. But here's the truth. Even though only a few have the gift of being an evangelist, all of the body of Christ has the role of evangelizing. We're all called to evangelize. We're just not all called to be evangelists, okay? And so it's great. I see how they do it. And all I've got to say to that is keep it up. I am grateful for people like that. But what about the rest of us? How are we gonna get the gospel out outside the four walls of the church house? I believe we can do it together if we'll do a couple things. Build and bring. Build relationships, build trust, build a friendship that develops enough to where someone would trust you so that if you said, I want to bring you to church, I want you to go to church with me, that when they got here, they would hear a message that would actually speak to their life and they could apply, like Carlos said, and that's an incredible blessing to find out that somebody thought the Hope series was written just for them. Only Jesus can do that stuff. And then they would hear music that didn't sound like somebody died. That sound like maybe even people were excited. The first time my mother-in-law came to church and saw people worshiping, she said to me when we got home, she said, do they see him? She says, because I didn't see him. I said, what do you mean? She said, do they see Jesus? I said, I don't think so. They do with their heart. They do with their eyes of faith and in their spirit. But they're just worshiping God. Come on. That they'll experience maybe awesome greeters, people who will pray for them, ushers that are kind, a children's facility and a children's ministry, that the kids will say, we're going to that church next Sunday. See, we're working hard as a body to present something that presents Jesus to people. And so if you can build a relationship with them and you can bring them here, guess what? We can do it together. We're not all evangelists, but we all are called to evangelize. And we're filling in some blanks today. Let's go ahead and fill them in. Together we will help them. Together we will show them. Together we will love them. And together we will lead them to Christ. Together we will help them. Together we will show them. Together we will love them. And together we will lead them to Christ. I think that's a great way to do church. It's really one of the reasons we do church the way we do it. See, they've heard about Christians and they're pretty sure they don't want to be one. I know that when I was looking for a way off my dead end street, I had no idea I could find it in church. See, they want to get off their dead end street, and I believe that's why God is raising up churches all across America and around the world, like East Coast Christian Center, like what's going on in Vieira, what's going on in Cocoa, what's going on in the Avenue, teaching in a way that's pretty normal and not sounding real theological and not using a Christianese that's so full of Christian words that people who come in can't understand it. Where the gifts of the Spirit flow, but they don't flow in a look at me way. We hear testimonies every week of miraculous things going on. Just last week, we got a prayer request for someone in Cocoa, someone new to the church who had a cancer issue that was serious. We prayed, they go back the next week, they can't find any cancer. Happened again this week in the parkway as well. Somebody had the pictures. They had the CT scan. They had a picture of tumors. The doctor says, you need to go to Shands. You need to go to a Mayo Clinic. You need to go somewhere. We can't handle this. This is a surgeon talking to them. Over the weekend, they receive prayer. They go back Monday for a cytoscope. And they can't find anything wrong with them. That isn't, look at this person doing these great things. No, that's all about, look at Jesus doing these great things. It's why we do church the way we do church. So that somebody comes in and they don't see a celebrity. They see people just like them. We lob it up. Come on, we lob it up. See, if one of my grandsons is out there with a baseball bat and I got the wiffle ball, I'm going to teach him how to hit the ball. He's new. He's been playing T-ball, but now he's got to learn how to hit it from a pitcher. You know what I do? I go like this. I go, tah! And I throw it right at his head. You're going to have to learn. No, I don't. I lob it up. I just go like this, and he goes. See, we're not, somebody new comes here, we're going, you right there in the fourth seat. You're addicted to crack. I like doing this. It's fun. See, a lot of times what we do when we don't do this right, we do stuff like this. We go, 42! People kind of go, what's this mean? Well, see, the problem is you're not asking the question, what's 6 times 6? Excuse me, 6 times 7. Durr. That was funny. I didn't do that on purpose either. Can I borrow $50? I'll pay you back all 36 of it. No, sorry. You didn't ask what 6 times 7 is. Here's what we do sometimes with people. We go, Jesus is the answer. And they're not asking the question yet. And so they look at you like, really? I wasn't really asking any questions about that. See, what we've got to do is we've got to get to know them, and we've got to get to love them and get into a relationship with them. See, here's if you're going to bring somebody to church, the first thing people want to know is who's going to bring them. See, don't look around, all right? Don't look around. But nobody wants to go anywhere with a crazy person. Come on now, think about it for a minute. When a crazy person asks you to go somewhere, some of you are trying not to laugh. I get it. It's all right. You're in church. Keep it tight, okay? All right. But nobody wants to go anywhere with a crazy person. In fact, if a crazy person invited you to the Super Bowl, you'd go, I'll pass. Now, if Denver was playing, I'd take a risk, all right? No, it's just me and crazy, we're going to the Super Bowl. So don't be that crazy Christian that doesn't work or isn't competent at work, but you're telling everybody about Jesus. If you don't do your job right, shutten sie uppen. That's German for be quiet. Can it. But work hard. Be competent. Display character. And then you're going to have an open door to tell somebody about Jesus. Everybody wants to know, well, if you're going to get an invitation to go somewhere, you want to know who's bringing me. Number two, you want to know who's going to be there. Or excuse me, what are we going to do there? I know that Carolyn and I were invited to church. We were invited and they said, we'll go. And it was in Boulder, Colorado. We lived in Denver. We actually lived in Littleton, which was on the south end of Denver. And so it was a long ways through Littleton and Inglewood and Denver and all the way to Boulder and another county 60 miles away about. And so it took about an hour and 20 minutes to get there. And so during the ride there, you know what they did? They told us about what it was going to be like. Because I was freaked out. I'm driving like, okay, we're going to church. Oh, my God. Oh, my God, we're going to church. Oh, my God, we're going to church. Oh, my God, why did I say yes? See, I was talking to God the whole way there. Oh, my God. But you know what they did? They relaxed us. They said, oh, we're just going to sing some songs. They actually had some of the songs there on a cassette deck or whatever it was. What was it? Maybe it was reel to reel. I don't know. Maybe it was two rocks. Back in the day, they scraped together two rocks and music came out or something. I don't remember what it was. Long time ago. Anyway, and then they talked about, you know, that the pastor was talking about faith and believing God. And then they'll pray for some people. And then afterwards, we'll go have some lunch. You know what they did? They caused us to relax. To go, whew, well, maybe we'll live through this. I quit saying, oh my God, for at least 15 minutes while they explained it. Last thing is when you get the invitation, somebody's going to bring you. You want to know who's going to bring you. You want to know what we're going to do there. And then you want to know who's going to be there. Number one thing, if you're to ask people in the community, what is the problem with the church or what's the problem with Christians? The number one thing they'll say is they're judgmental. Thank you for saying that with such feeling over there. Yep, that's it. We're a bunch of judgmental bums. But the problem is that's what the world thinks. What they've got to understand when they get here is that this place is full of people just like them. That's why we try to do what we do here with transparency. It's not like, well, if you guys were all as holy as me, then you'd be doing something. No. There go I, but by the grace of God. Paul the Apostle said, I'm the chief of all sinners. All have sinned and fallen short. There's nobody that made it into the kingdom of God, the family of God, based on their merit or their... We don't stay in the kingdom of God because of our behavior. We didn't get here because of it. We don't stay here because of it. We're not going to leave because of it. We're here because of the blood of Jesus. The work of Christ on Calvary. Who's here? The undeserving. Not a bunch of holier than thous. Don't forget to build before you invite, before you bring. I believe if we'll build in people's lives that it'll have a great effect. See, Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. So here's what that means. That means that even though we're in the church, we're part of the family, we have friends in the family, we must have friends outside of the family. I'm not talking about going out and doing crazy things. You don't have to do what the world's doing to be friends with somebody in the world? When Scripture says don't be a friend of the world, that means don't be a friend of the world system or sin. But it doesn't mean don't be a friend with people that are out there. In fact, if I wouldn't have had a friend reach out to me, I wouldn't be in the family of God. So we've got to have people in our lives that we're building relationships with. We want to build a relationship with people that we might win them to us. They'd trust us, they'd believe us, that we'd have a friendship, that we might lead them to Christ. Very powerful. See, quantities of time will lead to quality time with them. The question I want to ask is, who is God asking you to spend time with in 2015? Who is God calling you to invest time with, invest time in, build a relationship with in 2015? See, what happens is, as you build relationships with people, as you become friends with people, as they get to know you and you get to know them, what happens is you begin to know when something's going on in their life that is a moment of crisis or tension, or they're dealing with something. I think of a situation with somebody that I built a friendship with over a number of years, and they were dating and they thought this was the one and it was all looking very good, but then she left and it was bad and it hurt. Guess what? He was very receptive in those moments of like, what's going on with my life? You know what? There's another way to live rather than that culture you're trying to find hope and love in out there. And he comes to our church all the time now. He loves Jesus. Why? Because I got to know him well enough that I knew when he was hurting. And those are the moments that people are receptive. That's when he started asking the question, not what is 6 times 7, but is there any, what, I need help. Is there help for me in my pain? Back to the fishing story. I fished with Victor for two seasons. He was here 2 winters, and we probably went fishing 10, 12 times. I don't know how many times. And usually went with another fellow, Rusty Kaufman. And this time, Rusty had to go to work. And so as we came in from the ocean, we stopped by the ramp in Port Canaveral. And Rusty got off, got in his truck, and went to work. He worked out at the Cape. And we took the boat in through the port, through the locks, through the Banana River, over to where I lived. And so we were in the boat alone for about 45 minutes to an hour, getting from one place to another. Most of that time you go slow, so there's nothing to do but talk. And he asked me, finally, 2 years, never talked about the Lord, 2 years, he said, you know, can you just tell me a little bit about what my daughter and you believe about God? And so for the next 50 minutes, I just shared with him. Now, he didn't get saved that day. He listened. He asked a few more questions. He listened. We cleaned up the boat, cleaned the fish. He went home. And it was about February and Easter. His daughter said, do you want to go to church? Never been before. He said, yeah, I'll go. He and his wife sat about 5 rows back, right there in the center, here at this building. And when it was time to receive Christ, they put up their hands and said, we want to receive Jesus. Yeah. It takes time to build a relationship with somebody. But when you build a relationship with them, then it can be very powerful. Now, here's the question. Who should we build relationships? Who should we look to bring to church? Let me show you in the story of Jesus with the woman at the well in John chapter 4. Jesus goes to Samaria, which is a, a town of people that the Jews didn't get along with at all. They did not have any dealings. They didn't like them. They were of a different nationality and somewhat different religion. They still worship God, but they did a little bit differently. They didn't do it in Jerusalem. They did it there in their town. And they were a mixed race. They weren't all Jewish. They were mixed with some other races. And so the Jews had nothing to do with them. And so here Jesus is there, and the Samaritan woman is at the well in the middle of the afternoon, which isn't the time women come for water, but she's there then. And Jesus said, "Can I have a drink?" And she said, "What would you, a Jew, be asking me, a Samaritan woman, for? For you have no dealings with us." And he said, "If you knew who I was, you'd ask me for living water, and I'd give it to you, and you would never thirst again." She says, "I'll take some of that water so that I never have to come to this well and draw again." Jesus and her go on with a little bit of a conversation. It ends up where she says, "You know what? We worship here on this mountain. The Jews say we worship on that mountain. What's up with that?" Jesus said, "The day is coming and now is when men will worship me in spirit," or worship God in spirit and in truth. "Neither here nor there, but in spirit and in truth." And she says, "Messiah's coming. What do you know about that?" She says, "He who speaks to you, am he. I'm the Messiah." And she went, it ends up where he says to her, "You know, go get your husband." She says, "I don't have a husband." He says, "You're right, you don't. You've had five, and the man you have now is not your husband." She says, "You're a prophet." She runs back to town to tell everybody in town she's met the Messiah. That's going on over here. The disciples come back, and he starts talking to the disciples. And he says this to his disciples: "Do not say, or say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest." You know what I believe was happening right then? I believe the men of Samaria had heard what this woman said and were rushing out of the town, out of the city, to come to the well to see if this really was the Messiah. Jesus said, "Lift up your eyes and look. It's not harvest in 4 months. It's harvest right now. It's white unto harvest." They would have had white turbans on their head. And they were coming across the sand towards this well. You know what they were? They were a totally unaccepted, unreached group that no Jew was reaching out to. Why? Because they were unclean, overlooked. Here's what I think God is saying to us, is that there's a harvest right in front of us. At work, at school, in your neighborhood. So blessed. This morning, we had somebody from our street here in church. You just say, "Lord, thanks. Thanks for doing what you do in people's hearts." They're out there. But the problem is, we're going, "Oh, it'll happen, it'll happen." You know what? Remember what I said? It took me 2 years of building a relationship for this guy before he received it. So I'm not saying do something before it's time. But what I am saying, what I think God is saying here, is it's always time for somebody. The harvest is white. Lift it up. Lift up your eyes. Why? Because there's a harvest right in front of you. And years ago, we thought, who's a group that's not getting reached out to in Brevard County? And the answer that we came up with was young black men. So we built basketball courts out front. And we did basketball tournaments. And young black men began to come onto our property and began to get involved with our tournaments. And then their grandmothers started coming to our church. Today, when I walk in the back of our sanctuary, it is very rare that I don't shake hands with a young man with a family that didn't start out on those courts 10 years ago. To God be all the glory. Who's overlooked? You know, last night in our service, Overlook Ministry. What is that? The ministry to the homeless. They filled three rows last night. Three rows of our Saturday night service were full of overlook people. Come on. Our head usher last night used to live in a culvert. People used to drive over him and didn't even know he was there. But he was a harvest that God wanted to bring into the family of God. Yeah, we got clapped. God's so good. There are people out there like that. So here's what we need to do. Find the overlooked, the unnoticed, and begin to win a witness by building a relationship in people's lives so that we might bring them to church. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to make a list. Some of you will do this, some of you won't. I'm encouraging you. Make a list of people that God would have you build a relationship and bring to church this year. Here's something that I did. I heard this from somebody. I set my phone to 3:16. Excuse me, my watch alarm to 3:16. So every day at 3:16, my watch goes off. Beep, 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 beep. I look at it and go, there's my little tweet. Remember, you love everybody so much, God, that you sent Jesus. Help me to see. Help me to see differently. It's a little simple thing you can do. But I don't know about you guys, it's not enough for me to hear this stuff once. I need reminders all the time to keep me on track. Because life wants to push my head down. And God says, lift up your eyes and look, for the harvest is white. I'm going to pray and then we'll have a little video and then Pastor David will close. Lord, we just want to ask, who is it that you want us to build up, to build a relationship, to build trust with, so that we can bring them to church, so that we can point them to Christ. Lord, give us the eyes to see them, who, where, when, and also the courage to build a relationship. And then, Lord, help us to see the moments that they're receptive, and then bring them to church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I see a church where worship is on fire with a love and passion for God that displays an excellence that comes from the Holy Spirit. I see a church where new songs are birthed and the people of God are in one accord with all their strength, giving glory to their King. I see a church where cultures do not clash but blend into a worship that prepares us for heaven. I see a church where the Word of God is preached with clarity and conviction, with signs and wonders following. I see a church where God's people are growing up, showing up, and blowing up in the knowledge of the Word. I see a church where the people's desire to hear the Word of God and receive revelation is so strong, it's the easiest place in the world to preach. I see a church where the love of God is so strong that people like to just come and bask in acceptance and care. And because of that, there's no room for strife. I see a church where the people of God have tender hearts that are concerned with the eternal destiny of men. I see a church where the people are reaching out to their community so effectively that it is hard to go to hell from Brevard County. I see a church not afraid to use new strategies and wisdom from God to impact generations with the gospel. I see a church that is an apostolic work of God, blazing a trail in the destiny of God and so full of God's treasure, people, that it is bursting at the seams. I see a church that is white hot, ready and waiting for the soon return of her God and King, Jesus Christ. This is what I see when I look at East Coast Christian Center through the eyes of Jesus.
Man, what a great video. If you're a prayer counselor, if you could please make your way to the front. Pastor Ann talked and he talked about, you know, reaching out and inviting people, bringing people to church. But if you're here today and, you know, you've never stopped and just said, you know what? I don't know if I've ever had a conversation in God with God. I don't know if I've had that moment. You know, I don't know if I see God like how he was talking about. You know, we want to do that today. We want to have a moment with you. So if everybody will just close your eyes and just bow your heads. And the only reason we do that is just for concentration, just so we're not looking around, just so we're not distracted. The book of Romans in the Bible says that, you know, about Jesus, he says very clearly, he says, you know what you have to do? He says, confess with your mouth what you believe in your heart. He says, just say what you believe. And I know while Pastor Dan was preaching, there's probably many of us that God was just gently tugging on your heart. Some of us, he might have been outright pulling on your heart, saying, remember me, don't overlook me in this moment right now. He's letting you know that he loves you more than you can ever imagine. And he wants to make an exchange with you. Everything that you think's broken about you, for everything that's perfect in him. All of you for all of Jesus. And you know, we're not gonna put your picture on Facebook. We're not gonna do anything crazy, but what we're gonna do is we're gonna take a moment where you can just pray to your Heavenly Father and say, I'd like to make that exchange. I'd like to say what my heart is screaming right now, and that Jesus is the answer. And the Bible just says that we confess that he's Lord and Savior. So if you'd like to make that exchange, if you just take this next moment, if you just raise your hand up. I'm gonna pray with you guys. We're all gonna pray together. Go ahead and raise your hands up high. Don't worry, no one's looking around. I'm looking around, but that's just so I can know who I'm praying with. And later you guys can come down to the front in your own comfortable space and just talk to some of these prayer counselors and say, what just happened in my heart? What just happened in my life? Thank you. A lot of hands went up around the house right now. So if we could all just say this prayer together as a family, if you guys could just repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I turn from trusting myself and I fully trust in you. I put my hope in the name of Jesus and I give you my heart. You are my Lord and Savior. Heavenly Father, help me to follow you for as long as I live. In the name of Jesus, I pray. And all the believers said, now let's really put our hands together because a bunch of people are, come on. Come on. All right, man, a lot of hands went up around the room. I'm excited about that. Guys, if that was you and you raised your hand, something awesome just happened in your life. Come down and find out more about it. The rest of us, man, go and have a great day. We love you, you know. Go Seahawks. Go Patriots. Yeah.